Round Britain Quiz with Kirsty Lang.
Hello and welcome back to you and welcome back to our Round Britain quiz teams from Wales and the North of England, both making their second appearance in the 2023 series. Mavanwy Alexander and David Edwards play for Wales opposite Adele Garas and Stuart McConey for the North of England. We'll let them loose on the questions in a moment or two. We're just handing them their questions on paper now, a bit like the start of an exam. It really does feel like that, actually, as they turn their papers over. You might be hearing some sighs of despair, but I'll do my best to ignore them as I tidy up the cliffhanger puzzle I left you with at the end of last week's quiz. The question was, why might Bathsheba feel well disposed towards one of the racing classics, a district of Birmingham, and Tony Orlando's Million Seller? I think by RBQ standards, this was fairly easy. Bathsheba is Bathsheba Everdeen from Thomas Hardy's Far From the Madding Crowd, and the love of her life was the strong Gabriel Oak. The classic horse race is therefore the Oaks, run at Epsom since 1779. The district of Birmingham could be Selly Oak, and the best-selling record of Tony Orlando and Dawn was Tie a Yellow Ribbon Round the Old Oak Tree. So lots of sturdy oaks. Give yourself 6 points if you got all of those. Well, a lot of ferocious whispering going on indeed. So I think our panellists probably had enough time to think of something in response to the first question, and it is for you, Mavanwy and David. An ambassador with a sweet tooth, a scorer for the Toffees in 1966, and a sleuth with a wife called Steve. Where might they all worship? And I'm just going to ask that again. An ambassador with a sweet tooth, a scorer for the Toffees in 1966, and a sleuth with a wife called Steve. Where might they all worship? Mavanwy and David.
Yeah, I'm not quite sure where to start here. Can we go for the scorer for the Toffees?
I thought you'd start there, yes.
Yeah. Toffees are Everton. And a name crosses my mind, the name Mike Trebilco, spelt Trebilcock, but it's not him, is it? No. Okay. He famously scored in a cup final, but it may not have been.
But you are right about it being Everton.
Okay.
Well, the ambassador with the sweet tooth, the only thing that came to mind was a famous commercial where you spoil me, ambassador. This is not the one.
No, it was an unlikely ambassador. An ambassador with an unlikely career trajectory into the Foreign Service.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
What about the...
Is it Shirley Temple?
Okay, so...
And the sleuth with a wife called Steve is Simon Templar.
No. This is a sleuth from the golden age of radio.
Paul Temple.
Correct.
Paul Temple. Mm. Yeah. So a scorer for the Toffees must be called Temple. They'd worship, presumably, at the temple.
It was temple, Sam, but the scorer.
Right. No, I don't.
But you're absolutely right on all the others. They would worship in a temple.
Could I just add, by the way, to the reason why it's Shirley Temple with a sweet tooth? Because she had the hit on the Good Ship Lollipop.
That is absolutely correct. Yeah. So she was a US ambassador. She was a child star, of course, and singer at the age of five, and had that hit, the Good Ship Lollipop, and then later became a US ambassador, I think, to Ghana and later to Czechoslovakia.
So we've got Shirley Temple.
Paul Temple.
We've got Paul Temple. And yeah.
You've still got to get the Everton player
yeah. Temple.
Temple.
Dave Temple, Terry Temple.
Yeah. And it's one of those sort of names that's slightly gone out of fashion now.
Derek.
Derek.
It is Derek, is it?
Yeah.
Right.
It is indeed Derek Temple, scored the late winner for Everton in the 1966 FA Cup final. Mm. I think we're 4 out of 6. OK, North of England, this is a listener's question, kindly sent to us at rbq@bbc.co.uk by Fiona Jenkins. Thank you, Fiona, for this one. And it is, where might you find a statistician with a lamp, a very naughty boy, a singer-songwriter with a Nobel Prize, and the father of the Sons of Thunder? And in what direction would they be travelling? Where might you find a statistician with a lamp, a very naughty boy, a singer-songwriter with a Nobel Prize, and the father of the Sons of Thunder? And in what direction would they be travelling?
The singer-songwriter with a Nobel Prize is Bob Dylan.
Yeah, the very naughty boy. Mm. He's not the Messiah, he's a very naughty boy. He's Brian in Monty Python's Life of Brian.
And we think, though it's counterintuitive, we think the statistician with the lamp must be Florence Nightingale.
And then the right. Sons of Thunder is Dougal. Which so the direction they'd be travelling in is...
Round and round on the magic roundabout.
That's you're absolutely right. Actually, it wasn't the father of the Sons of Thunder. Dougal wasn't. Somebody else.
Oh, OK.
No. The father of... Are there any other male characters on the magic roundabout? Brian, Dougal?
Zebedee? Of course, Zebedee from the Bible. Of course.
That is absolutely correct. And so tell us a little bit more, if you will, about the magic roundabout. Its origin, it was inspired by
Sophie and Emma Thompson's dad who invented it for them.
No, he didn't invent it. Eric Thompson voiced the English language version of a French programme made by Serge Dano.
Ah, right.
Exactly, called...
Le carousel du magique.
It was Le manège enchanté.
Okay.
All right.
The magic, yes. Anyway, well done, North of England. 5 out of 6 for that. David Mavanwy, time for a music question for you. You will get 4 sound clips to consider. And while you listen, I want you to think about this question. Why could these leave you all at sea? Okay, so you heard 4 extracts, and the question you need to answer, and it's quite a tricky one, this, is why could these leave you all at sea?
Let's try and identify the ones that we do know. The second one was a bit of a Sibelius. I think that was a section of Finlandia.
Absolutely right.
And the third one was The Ride of the Valkyrie by Wagner.
You've got the wrong...
Ride of the Valkyrie.
It is right. It is Wagner, but it's the wrong bit. The
Flying Dutchman, possibly?
Yeah.
Yeah.
David Essex singing I'm Gonna Make You a Star. Yeah.
Correct. So that just leaves you with the first, those noises.
It sounded like something from a video game, but I don't know what. Did you make any sense of that?
No. So we've got Finlandia. We've got the Flying Dutchman.
Dutchman, which has got a sea reference. Yeah.
Yes. You might be particularly all at sea, especially during the Olympics.
Right, these are yachting classes.
Categories.
Mm. So let's just recap. On the third bit of music, you've got Wagner's Flying Dutchman. Right? Yep. So
there's not an Essex class.
Is there a star class? Is there a star class? Okay, there's a star class.
And then, you've got Finlandia as the clue, so you've got to extrapolate it from that.
Finn class, yes. Right. Yeah.
And then you've just got the first one. It's some sort of sound effects from a very familiar sci-fi show.
So it's music to zap your alien bar or something like that.
Yes, but it's a pretty well-known class of sailing boat.
Yeah, I'm sure. It's not one of those with a numerical name, is it?
No.
No, okay.
But if you think about the sort of weaponry that might have been used...
Laser! Yeah.
Yes, that is. Yeah.
We got there in the end. Okay, so do you want to just recap that for us? Why would all of these leave you at sea?
Well, they're all Olympic sailing classes or sailing classes which may or may not be included in the Olympics. First one, laser class. Second one, fin class. Third one, Flying Dutchman. And third one, star.
That's right. Fourth one, star, which we got from David Essex, going to make you a star. Mm. Well, I had to give you quite a lot of help on that one. It was very difficult, though. 3 out of 6 to Wales. OK, north of England, Adele and Stuart, who have been doing some very furious whispering. I don't know if that's a good or a bad sign. Here's another listener's idea, and it's from Don Fitzpatrick. What connects the following to a 1964 Elvis Presley musical? A dictator literally and symbolically toppled in 2003, the inventor of detective fiction and the father of science fiction. What connects the following to a 1964 Elvis Presley musical? A dictator literally and symbolically toppled in 2003, the inventor of detective fiction and the father of science fiction.
Well, the last two, I guess, are open to some debate, but let's explore the possibilities. The Murders in the Rue Morgue by Edgar Allan Poe is often reckoned to be the first detective story. Is that, would I be on the right lines?
And we think the father of science fiction might be H.G. Wells.
Yeah.
And the dictator toppled symbolically and literally in 2003 is Saddam Hussein.
Which gives us Hussein, Wells and Poe.
And we cannot think of an Elvis Presley musical.
So let's try and work this out. We're trying to think of those cheesy... I mean, Elvis Presley was making about 3 films a year. So it's so 64, we'd be thinking maybe Viva Las Vegas, Roustabout, Aloha from Hawaii, Blue Hawaii... There's so many of them from that time, so...
I'm more interested in what Saddam, Edgar Allan Poe,
and
H.G. Wells have in common with one another.
Something to do with their personal lives.
Is it something to do with their relationships?
Yes.
Yes, it's something to do with them wives or...
Mistresses?
Yes.
Mistresses.
Yes. No, wives.
Wives.
Yeah. They married people who, strictly speaking, these days, one wouldn't.
Cousins?
Oh, kissing cousins. Kissing cousins is the Elvis movie.
Okay, so...
Well done.
Saddam
Wow, that's
and
a good
Edgar
question.
Edgar Allan Poe and H.G.
So Saddam Hussein, his first marriage was to his cousin, Sajida Tulfa, and it was an arranged marriage.
Right.
Edgar Allan Poe married his much younger cousin, Virginia Clemm, with whom he fell in love while staying with her mother, his aunt, in Baltimore. And H.G. Wells also married his cousin, Isabel Mary Wells, although they were separated after 3 years when Wells began an affair with one of his students. And the musical that Elvis Kissing Presley musical Cousins. 1964 was Kissing Cousins. Well done for that. 5 out of 6. Okay, next question to Wales. How does Laurie's cowboy beau combine with the Velvet Underground's drummer and Dennis the Daxon's Toy Town pal to create an American vaudeville act? So how does Laurie's cowboy beau combined with the Velvet Underground drummer and Dennis the Daxon's Toy Town pal to create an American vaudeville act?
Well, I think Dennis's pal might be a way into this. And I think it might be the pal who used to say, but I'm only a little lamb, sir. So Larry the Lamb,
maybe,
who's been
there.
Referred to there.
Yeah,
showing my age. And I noticed there are three elements apart from the thing that pulls them all together here. So I wonder if we're looking at a three-handed vaudeville act. Three Stooges?
It is indeed
right,
the Three okay. Stooges.
Who were, in their heyday, were named Curly, Larry and Moe. There was at one time one called Shemp, but I don't know what happened to him. Anyway, Curly is also the name of the hero of Oklahoma.
As in the farmer and the cowman should be friends. Yeah. One man ropes a cow with ease, the other man steals her butter and cheese, but that's no reason why they can't be friends. That Curly.
So yeah. we can therefore we can say with great confidence that our encyclopedic knowledge of the Velvet Underground includes the fact that their drummer's called Mo. Do you need more?
Any idea of the real name of the drummer?
Morris. No, Morgan.
Wrong
all
gender.
I know is they've got Lou Reed and John Cale.
It was a girl, wasn't it? It was a female drummer.
Ah, Maureen?
Maureen, yeah, yeah.
It was Maureen Tucker, but known as Mo.
Yeah.
I think I'm going to give you 5 out of 6. I've got to probably deduct a point for the slight haziness over Mo. But well done on the rest. Okay, Adele and Stuart, some music for you now. I want you to listen to this sequence and ponder this question. Why might you fear taking a ride with these four?
I've never seen you looking so lovely as you did tonight. I've never seen you shine so bright.
Say you're sorry, that face of an angel comes out just when you need it to. As I pace back and forth all this time, 'cause I honestly believed in you.
So you heard 4 pieces of music. Why might you fear taking a ride with these four?
Are we thinking about colours?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, we know the Lady in Red, you know, beautiful sounds of Christa Berg, though, with Lady in Red.
And an instrumental version of Paint It Black.
Yeah.
And a whiter shade of
and
pale.
And a whiter shade of pale. So white, red and black. And that second song sounded like it might be Taylor Swift. But Taylor Swift isn't a colour. Ah, but the name of the song we're looking for by Taylor Swift is...
Lots of colours.
Yeah, well, I'm trying to think I'm trying to think of my blue? No.
Actually, strictly speaking, in the fourth title, Whiter Shade of Pale, you've got more than
one colour.
Oh, there's more than one colour, yeah. There's white and... If you think pale is a colour...
I mean, bear in mind that you need to fear them.
Yes.
We resisted mentioning a song by Aphrodite's Child, which I know that Stuart has played on his show.
Oh, are they the four horsemen of the apocalypse? The pale one, the leading horse is white,
yeah.
The second horse is red,
yeah.
The third one is a black. The last one, is pale. One of them is called pale. It's the four horsemen of the apocalypse.
Yeah. Yes, yeah. It's from the Book of Revelations. Well done. So let's just recap what the pieces are.
So Lady in Red by Christa Berg. Paint It Black, I'm not sure who that was.
I'm not sure who that was, but it was Paint It Black.
That was Rick Wakeman, Paint It Black.
Mm. Right.
And presumably Procol Harum for...
For pale.
Whiter shade of pale.
So what have we missed out then? So
Swift, Taylor Swift.
That was White Horse.
Yeah. Right. Oh, we not... Right. Okay, right. We not say that. Red, white, black and pale. Yes.
Yeah. So I think 4 out of 6 for that.
Okay.
Wales. Question 7. You might express surprise at finding one on the north coast of Devon, 2 in the province of Quebec, and for a time you would have found one in Ohio, but it's no longer there. What am I talking about? You might express surprise at finding one on the north coast of Devon, 2 in the province of Quebec, and for a time you would have found one in Ohio, but it's no longer there. What am I talking about?
When we express surprise in a Round Britain quiz question, and the north coast of Devon is involved, I instinctively go for Westward Ho. Would I be right in this thought?
I think your instincts are correct in this case, yes.
And in which case, the expression of surprise might be the exclamation mark, which is an unusual thing to find in a place name.
So correct.
Are we looking for other place names that contain an exclamation mark?
You are.
Right. I have a feeling in the back of my mind which may be totally unjustified, that at one time Cincinnati had an exclamation mark on it. So it's not Cincinnati, I'm guessing from your surprised expression. With Quebec, we're floundering a little bit, but perhaps looking for expletives that a French trapper might sort of give off.
Zut alors!
Zut alors! Sacre bleu! So, I don't know, sorry.
It's more
apologies to any French listeners.
Yes, yeah. Maybe a French English country house garden designer.
Capability Brown?
I think maybe if you don't know it, I might have to give it
well,
to you.
I don't think so. The only.
It does relate to a particular garden feature found in large
ha,
country.
Ha 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 ha! So it's ha ha. Both of the ha's having an exclamation mark.
Yes,
right.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it is Saint Louis du ha ha in Quebec.
Right.
And so we're just looking now for one in Ohio, but it's no longer there.
So is the settlement no longer there, or simply the exclamation mark and the name is
the
as it's always been? And it's not Cincinnati?
No.
So what other place? It's not Cleveland, it's not Dayton, it's not Springfield. Trying to think of other Ohio.
Philadelphia?
Named
no, that's not in Ohio.
A founding father?
Oh, okay. Washington.
Jefferson.
Oh, wait a moment. This isn't Hamilton, is it? Right,
yeah.
Which I don't think Hamilton.
So the city.
Did the city have an
exclamation mark? So Hamilton in Ohio, briefly in the 80s, added an exclamation mark as a part of a marketing plan hatched by the authorities to increase its profile and attract visitors. Sadly, didn't work. So they removed it. Let's just a recap. So you might express surprise at finding one on the north coast of Devon. Many people assumed that the immensely popular 1855 Charles Kingsley novel Westward Ho! Was named after the village, but in fact it was the other way around. And then you've got Saint-Louis du Haha, two exclamation marks, in Quebec. The origin of the name is obscure, but we think it could perhaps relate to the sort of a garden feature or an unexpected ditch or steep drop, which isn't visible until you're right on top of it. So I think probably 3 out of 6 for that. So, final question, north of England, Stuart and Adele. This has been suggested by a regular listener, Joe Wainwright. What have Kathleen Turner and Michael Douglas got to do with Falstaff's mustard, a Cockney's hair, Orlando's former lady friends, and Vic Reeves' comedy partner in A State of Rage? What have Kathleen Turner and Michael Douglas got to do with Falstaff's mustard, a Cockney's hair, Orlando's former lady friend, and Vic Reeves' comedy partner in A State of Rage?
Well, there is a movie with Kathleen Turner and Michael Douglas which, if we could only remember the name of this movie...
But it will come back to us as we work our way through.
Yes, but the theme was...
They're a warring...
Divorce.
Warring couple. Hold on to that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So...
A Cockney's hair, we assume, is Barnet.
It is, in Cockney rhyme and slang.
Yeah.
Barnet fair hair.
Yeah.
And Vic Reeves' comedy partner is Bob Mortimer. So we're thinking Bob. No?
We should be thinking Mortimer, then. Are these warring families?
You're very warm.
Yes.
It's kind of wider than that, but...
Okay.
Any idea about Orlando's former lady friend?
Are we thinking about Orlando by Virginia Woolf?
Thinking more Hollywood.
Oh, you're thinking Orlando Bloom.
Yeah.
Oh, right. Okay, so what was Orlando Bloom in?
Who had a relationship with...
No, I can honestly say I don't know the answer to that.
Okay, but I think you might get to it once you get the overall theme. Let's think about Falstaff's mustard.
Falstaff's mustard? Does he express a preference for mustard in the plays?
Well, in Act 2 of Henry IV, Part 2, describing Poins, he says, his wit is as thick as... something, mustard. Let's go back to as you correctly identified, Kathleen Turner and Michael Douglas were in a well-known film.
Yes, very well.
1989, about a battling couple
yes.
at war.
Yes.
And although that was an American film, it's actually the rest of the question relates to a very English theme.
English.
I mean, in fact, the link is to do with a very old rivalry in yeah. your part of the country.
Yes, it's
Is it Wars,
is it Wars
and
of the Roses?
The Wars
it's the
of
Wars
the
Roses.
Of the Roses.
Oh, it's called... That's what the film's called.
That's what it's
that's
called.
What the film's called. The film's called The War...
Oh, golly. See, we could have saved ourselves a lot of
that's
trouble.
That's what the film's
so
called.
If that's yeah, a, so that's what that, connects yeah. them. So then you've got a Barnett, you corrected, yeah. you've got Mortimer.
Yeah.
What do they refer to?
Are these just warring dynasties in The Wars of the Roses? Houses?
Battles.
Oh.
There's certainly a battle fought in Barnett.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mortimer's not a place, is it? No.
Clearly it is.
So are these sites of battles?
They are indeed sites of battles. Yeah.
During the Wars of the
During
Roses.
During the Wars of the Roses.
Yeah.
Well.
Oh, well, I think I'm...
I'm done.
Wars of the Roses battle sites. I think I'm out.
I think
okay.
I'm out. I think I'm out.
All right. Well, these are all prominent battles in the Wars of the Roses. So Falstaff's mustard, he talks about... Falstaff says the poems, his wit as thick as Tewkesbury mustard.
I was going to say Tewkesbury. I was just about to say Tewkesbury mustard, yes.
Yeah. Which gives us the battle of Tewkesbury. you correctly identified Barnett. Orlando Bloom was in a relationship with the actress Kate Bosworth for a time.
Oh, okay.
Battle of Bosworth.
Oh, my goodness.
And then we've got Vic Reeves' comedy partner is Bob Mortimer. And if he were in a state of rage, it might suggest the Battle of Mortimer's Cross.
Okay, yes.
I did have to give you quite a few clues, so I'm afraid that's just 2 out of 6.
Okay.
Yes, I think that's fair.
Despite that, you still managed to win, because here we are at the end of the show and you got 16 points, North of England, and Wales got 15. Well done and congratulations. It wasn't an easy round. It means that with all our teams having played twice so far this season, the RBQ league table is headed jointly by Northern Ireland and the North of England, who have won both of their matches so far. Next time, the South of England play the Midlands in the first of the revenge matches that take up the second half of the series. And I will have the solution to this question, which I'm going to leave you to think about till we next meet. So if you're at a loose end in the next few days with a cup of coffee, you might consider this. In what way might Bismarck, the painter of a perfect circle and a nationwide raffle, embrace the adult version of Tiswas? Don't write in. I'll tell you next time. Good luck and goodbye until then.